Good afternoon, everyone. The future of international dispute resolution centres the Garfield principle. Yes, Garfield. This morning, a friend came over to the courts, a lawyer. He left Dubai a few years ago. He went back to Jersey. And I said, I'm really sorry, I don't have much time. I just want to finish my speech for a presentation this afternoon. He said, where are you presenting? I said, at the Kluwer conference. Looked a bit puzzled. He said, I prefer Bayes. I don't think he'd understood what we were talking about today. This presentation is in the spirit of Jonathan Swift's A Modest Proposal. Without the infanticide. What I'm going to say, in some measure, is intentionally confrontational. And it's meant to be thought-provoking. You may have already gathered that from the title. What on earth has the future of dispute resolution centres got to do with a fat and cynical orange cat noted for its laziness, smug sarcasm, and an intense passion for lasagna? I'll focus primarily on arbitration centres in the region, but I think the principles apply more broadly to all dispute resolution centres in the region, including commercial courts. Crisis. The end is nigh, ladies and gentlemen. Well, not quite. But it isn't far away. Lehman's failed on the 14th of September 2008. It was a huge surprise to everybody, and the impact was very swift indeed, as the graph suggests. The warnings were there. Bear Stearns had failed in the March before. The cracks were in the dam. And given that we all have a PhD in hindsight, we all saw them. But today, the speed of change and the ability of change to engulf an entire sector is greater than ever before. And I'd like you to remember the words on that placard. Who will be next? Will you be next? Because the issue for us in this region is supply and demand. The issue about dispute resolution centres is about supply and demand. How many court systems do we have in the UAE?
Seven.
I counted six, it could be seven. Choice is brilliant, but it must be sustainable. Take arbitration centres in the Middle East, North Africa. At the last count, there are 49, many of you heard me right, 49 arbitration centres in the Middle East, North Africa, and that was before EMAC was formed. So we now have 50 arbitration centres in the Middle East and North Africa. That, ladies and gentlemen, is more than we have central banks. Most, if not all, are funded by government. Many governments are operating a budget deficit. We have seen recovery in the price of oil, but we're also seeing focus at a government level on how they spend their money. Do we need 50 arbitration centres? Are they offering the choice that people want? A recent survey of the DIFC Academy of Law surveyed lawyers from around the world, and it asked them what they wanted from a dispute resolution centre. Pretty uniformly, they only want three things: enforceability, fairness, and speed. Enforceability, fairness, and speed. Those were the three primary drivers for selecting a dispute resolution centre, not whether it was arbitration or litigation, not how magnificent the stand was at the latest conference, not the location of the centre. In fact, for disputes, what we're seeing more than ever is forum shopping. People are willing to look beyond their region for a centre that offers enforceability, fairness and speed. When we go to our General Counsel forum in the DIFC and you talk to them about location, they're entirely agnostic. When you push them hard, they say, if there's anything in the West, we go to London. If there's anything in the East, we go to Singapore. And if there's anything in the middle, we come to DIFC. And that's when pushed. So I thought I would get some empirical data for you about trends in arbitration. I thought that might be helpful, ideally, to reinforce my argument. But empirical data is really hard to find on global arbitration. Many law firms, I'm very grateful for the advice that they put up on the website, but they profess to offer abilities in arbitration solutions. And those websites and that data that they provide suggest that arbitration is the future and the future is bright. The arbitration centres themselves put out fairly selective data, which again always seems to paint a very rosy picture. But the World Bank has done a survey and it paints a slightly different, more nuanced, perhaps more concerning picture. Whilst it suggests that some area of arbitration is growing, and good growth, that growth is selective both in terms of subject matter and in terms of location. The reality for many centres is that they are declining. And not just from a 2009 peak. HK Hong Kong, DIAC, CTAC, all report declining caseloads. CIAC in Singapore, I thought was going to be the shining light. I thought it was going to show me real growth in arbitration because it's relatively new. 2013, it had 259 cases. 2014, it lost 15%, down to 222. In fact, the 2015 figures only showed 5% increase on the 2013 figures. So even the Trojan horse wasn't giving me the data to suggest that arbitration centres are flourishing. Investment treaty arbitration is declining. The financial services sector, with some exceptions, prefers efficient commercial courts to arbitration. So whilst I think it's fair to say from the research I did that arbitration overall is on the increase, that's good news, I think it's not universal. I think as disputes are finding a home, they're finding a home that offers enforceability, fairness and speed, irrespective of location. There are other pressures. Of all of the general counsel on the general counsel forum, only one says that they would prefer arbitration over litigation. They perceive, and I think in many cases they're wrong, but they perceive it to be slower and more expensive than litigation. They perceive that talent is scarce, both amongst arbitrators, counsel, and within the arbitration centres, the people handling the progression of the case. Now, I know we're blessed in this room to have the best of the best, but look beyond the UAE, out into the Middle East and North Africa, and ask yourself if that perception is fair. There's a sense that the international courts are doing a bit better than they did in the past, that they're offering enforceability, fairness, and speed. And there's a sense, in contrast to treaty-based enforcement that you find with courts, that arbitral enforcement remains challenging, and perhaps ever more so, given the propensity of some to, let's say, push the ethical boundaries in support of an award debtor. Lastly, opacity or privacy was seen to be an advantage, but it seems less and less to be the case. As Justice David Williams once said, sunlight is the best disinfectant. So,
We might be said to have too much choice or oversupply. We might be said that the market is getting ever more globalized, where location is not a motivator, certainly not as strong as enforceability, fairness, and speed. We have governments looking to refine expenditure in countries with multiple arbitration centers, all costing money. And we have the dissatisfaction of the customer at the end of the ability of the process to deliver what they need. So what will happen? Many of you will say that we've seen failure already in India. We have seen an arbitration centre fail already. And when it fails, what happens to the contracts that have specified that centre? They need to be changed, right? You can't have your client with a contract which specifies a dispute goes to a centre which is closed. And will the lawyers choose another small, regional, loss-making arbitration centre for the clause? Once bitten, twice shy? And what about new contracts being drafted by lawyers? They've seen the centre fail in the region. What will they select? Another small, regional, loss-making centre dependent on the government to survive? Is that what they'll pick for their client? Will they pick one of the 50 that we've got in the region? No. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the Garfield principle. If we're not careful, and bear in mind this is meant to be contentious, by the way, if we're not careful, the future of international commercial arbitration will trend not towards Darwin's principle of the survival of the fittest, but it will trend towards Garfield's principle, the survival of the fattest. The fat and cynical orange cat, which is noted for his laziness, smug sarcasm, and intense passion for lasagna, is an allegory for some of the biggest dispute resolution centres in the world, except for the lasagna. The biggest and most robust centres will get even bigger and more robust, because they will be safe centres. It will be the IBM principle. And if the closure of an arbitration centre in India is our Bear Stearns moment, how long before we have our Lehman's moment? How long before one of the 49 or 50 arbitration centres in Middle East and North Africa is closed? It won't be called closure, but the effect will be the same. And to pursue the analogy, how quickly will we then see a flight towards the Garfield centres? Who will be next? Will you be next? Will be the question asked of our smaller regional centres. So what can we do about it? Take action. We should take action, and we should do it soon. What action? Collaborate. Just as the DIFC court is now the most connected commercial court in the world, other dispute resolution centres need to start connecting. They need to start collaborating. Why not make the rules look similar? Why not homogenise the rules? Is being different so much better? Are the rules so special that we need a unique approach across every arbitration centre? Why don't we share marketing, cluster the offering to present a unified message, enhance the efficiency of the marketing spend? That's not to do away with each centre marketing itself, but when we're presenting internationally, form a star alliance of arbitration centres. Share facilities. International arbitration involves people from all around the world. Why force them all to come to one place? Let them connect remotely through a network of connected arbitration centres. Dispute resolution as a service, not as a place. Celebrate specialization, not compete with it. Work together. Embrace the specialist Islamic rules that Malaysia has developed. Embrace the focus on maritime that we have with the Emirates Maritime Arbitration Center, and work together to offer the full range of services throughout the network. Share technology. Operate on interchangeable platforms. Make the user experience enhanced and uniform wherever they are. Enhance interoperability. Focus on supporting international enforcement. Offer training and development throughout the network. These are just some of the ideas that, when we look at arbitration of the future, and to an extent, dispute resolution of the future. And I want you to think, this is not just about arbitration. This is about small commercial courts that are still of the view that they should be isolationist. When we look at arbitration of the future, what we need to see is a shared success. Best practices should be shared. The stronger centres in our region should bring up those that are more in need of support. We should see arbitration and dispute resolution not in terms of market share, not in terms of net revenues, but in terms of whether they serve the needs of the people that come to them and ask for help. And those needs are simple, ladies and gentlemen. Enforceability, fairness, and speed. If we don't start collaborating as regional dispute centres, then I recommend to everyone involved in regional arbitration and dispute resolution, learn to cook lasagna. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. A little more frank than light-hearted, but that's very interesting and welcome take on what's happening there. Our next speaker this afternoon is Melissa K. Curry, who is a partner in the dispute resolution team at Hadef and Partners here in Dubai. And she is another genuinely international lawyer, having practiced in London, Moscow, Perth, and now for